topics, we have with us Professor Marco Botta, which is a senior researcher at the Max Planck Institute in Munich, and he's teaching as well in Vienna, as far as I know. And he's going to change the topic. We're still with data, but with exploitative conduct as an abuse of dominant position. So, Professor Botta.
Okay, so. Okay, thank you very much, Carmen. If you can hear me, and if you don't mind, I will stand. So thank you very much, Carmen, and the other organizer for organizing this very interesting conference. I'm happy to be here today and to share my thoughts about this research. What happened here? So the paper that I will present today, it's part of a broader research project that we are currently carrying out at the Max Planck Institute for Innovation and Competition in Munich. The project is directed by Professor Drexel, and I'm the coordinator of the project. So we have a common research question, which is whether and to what extent the traditional competition law principles are applicable to the realities of that economy. And we discuss this, this question in different papers co-authored by different researchers looking at different type of conducts, competition law, anti-competitive conducts in the context of that economy. So, in particular, we look at the theory of harm and at the possible competition law remedies, while we skip the discussion on relevant market and market power. So this is a specific choice. We think that a lot has already been said and written about how to define the relevant market in that economy, about two-sided markets, whether you use quality parameters to define the relevant market, and we have a sort of normative debate about market power. So on one side, you have some authors, like this current my position and the position of the Max Planck, is that digital markets are characterized by entry barriers, specifically large amount of data creates direct and indirect network externalities. So this is a sort of, I would call it interventionist camp, to say competition law has a role to play in digital markets. While tomorrow, for instance, you will hear the presentation by a friend of mine, Maria Teresa Maggiolino from Bocconi, who will say there is no market power in digital market simply because you can transfer data from one platform to another and because the value of the data decreases quickly. So this is a sort of normative debate. You cannot reconcile it. So either you are on one side or on the other side. That's why we decided to discuss other two aspects, the theories of harm and the possible remedies, which are less discussed simply because we have less or sometimes no court decisions, no decision by the competition authority. So our research is somehow more speculative, looking a bit at the future developments in this field. And we rely on a common database of decision adopted by the European Commission and by the major competition authorities in Europe, the Bundeskartellamt, UK, the French and Italian competition authority, where data remedies have already been imposed. So, data remedies, when I think about data remedies, I think about obligation of data sharing or even divestiture of a data set are not new, let's say. We already saw them in several merger cases and abuse of dominant position cases in the past in other markets like financial industry, agriculture, airline sectors, and so on. So we somehow look at these remedies and then we somehow try to understand what can be applicable in terms of remedies to the digital markets. This is the idea of the project. So let's now come to the paper. So the paper that I co-authored with Klaus, it's focused on exploitative abuses in that economy. So what are exploitative abuses are the conducts which directly harm final consumers or customers. So they are not exclusionary, so they don't exclude competitors. And if you read Article 102 of the treaty, you find at least three types of exploitative conducts which are sanctioned. So excessive pricing, discriminatory pricing, and unfair contractual conditions, which are also type of conducts which could be relevant happening in the debt economy. So we could think about excessive pricing in terms of excessive amount of personal data that, for instance, an online platform requires to the users in order to get access to a service, if we consider personal data as a sort of currency to get an online service. We know that discriminatory pricing it's taking place. So we know that we pay different price when we purchase on, I don't know, Amazon or eBay, and we are discriminated on the basis of different factors, like, I don't know, browsing history, geographical position, and so on. And when we talk about unfair contractual clauses, we probably can think in the realm of the data economy about the unilateral imposition by a platform of some kind of terms and conditions which, for instance, hamper our privacy, for instance. So this is actually the Facebook case investigated by the Bundeskartellamt that I will talk about that later. So traditionally, exploitative conducts have been rarely enforced, both by the European Commission and by national competition authority for a number of reasons. So first of all, there is a risk of overlaps with sectoral regulation. So there is a risk of competition authority to become a regulator, so to exceed its, let's say, boundaries, its task. And also because the burden of proof has traditionally been quite higher, let's say. However, we can see a sort of new trends in the last years. So we have a number of exploitative conduct, especially excessive pricing, sanctioned in a number of network industries. Think about electricity and gas markets. And also the case of standard essential patents, that when the owner of a standard essential patent should be required to license its patent under frank terms, fair and non-discriminatory terms. But what happens, let's say, if actually the license is not frank and the royalty requested is too high? So this would be also a sort of case for excessive pricing, and there have been some enforcement cases. So I would say there is a sort of, personally, my personal position, the sort of emerging trends, a revival, I would call it, about exploitation in Europe. And the question that we discuss in this paper is whether this revival, we also see it in the context of the data economy. What are the possible exploitative conducts in the data economy? What are the main enforcement challenges that the National Competition Authority and the European Commission will have to face to prove a case in this field? In particular, we look at the traditional case law of the Court of Justice in this field, and we try to understand what are the standards that the National Competition Authority and the European Commission will have to prove in order to, let's say, make a case under Article 102 in terms of exploitation. And finally, in the paper, we also discuss, this is more like a speculation, I would say, about possible remedies. So, before I move to exploitative abuses, I would like to open a sort of parenthesis about the scope of application of EU competition law in data economy. So the data markets are, this is the position that we take in the paper, characterized by a number of market failures. Market failures broadly intended here, linked to the idea of the privacy paradox. So what is the privacy paradox? Consumers, users officially say that they care about their privacy online, but de facto they act in a different manner. So de facto they accept all the possible conditions about the use of their data online, they accept the transfer freely of their data. So they don't somehow act in accordance with their required preferences. And the market in itself cannot offer solutions to this type of problems. That's why we see a market failure here. Specifically, we see, let's say, the common policy of online platforms, take it or leave it. So either you accept our data protection terms, or you don't get the service. And the lack of transparency, so you need to spend 1 hour in order to understand, if you will manage, the privacy terms, okay? So these are, in our opinion, market failures, which a priori, I'm still talking about exploitative conducts, but a priori do not at least exclude the enforcement of EU competition law in this sector. And also, another argument which is all usually put forward is that we now have the GDPR, a very broad a comprehensive legislation about data protection, so we should not enforce EU competition law anymore in this field, at least when there is an overlap with privacy issues. And our answer is that it's true, we have the GDPR, it's comprehensive, but remember that that covers only personal data. So non-personal data, like anonymized data, are not covered by the GDPR. Anonymized data are very common, actually, in the data economy. And you can anonymize the data, but then via data mining, you can connect the dots, and you can somehow re-identify the subject. So we don't think the GDPR is a sort of panacea to solve all the problems in this field. Another argument, again, about the scope of application, it's the overlap with other legislation about other policy. So another typical argument of the non-enforcement camp is that we have consumer law protection, we have data protection law, so why should we also enforce competition law in data markets? And our argument in the paper is that consumer law, data protection, and competition law have different enforcement tools, different objectives, different scope of application. So the legality of a conduct under one area of law does not exclude the enforcement of other areas of law. Okay? Very often the argument, the reference is to the Aspnex ruling of the European Court of Justice, approximately 10 years ago, in which the court say competition law cannot be used to achieve data protection goals. That's true, we all agree about that. So competition law is there to solve market failures, which are present in the data economy, as I show in my previous slides. And in Deutsche Telekom and AstraZeneca, also the court makes clear that we cannot exclude the application of one area of law if that conduct is illegal in another area of law. Okay? So there is a sort of normative approach that we take in the paper. However, we are aware, when we come to the issue of exploitative conducts, that we should be, how to say, very careful, okay, not to run the risk of competition law becomes a regulation, because that's not the task of competition law, okay? And we analyze the case law of the Court of Justice in the cases of exploitative conducts, and also the sort of economic review, the review of the economic literature, and we conclude that competition law should sanction exploitative conducts only in exceptional circumstances, when we have cases of superdominance, not pure dominance, and very high and stable entry barriers. So somehow exceptional cases, probably like some cases which can take place in the data economy. So let's now come to the three exploitative conducts that I mentioned before. So excessive pricing. So it's mentioned in Article 102.A, imposing unfair purchase on selling price. So the this type of conduct was sanctioned for the first time in United Brands by the Court of Justice. There the court introduced a double limb to show the existence of excessive pricing. So the price has to be excessive, and in that case the court referred to the cost price test, and also has to be unfair. And the unfairness can be related to unfair per se, so the price is simply too high, I don't know, 7 times higher than the competitors, or unfair because higher in comparison to the economic value of the product, even though the court did not clarify what is the economic value of the product and how to determine. More recently, in September last year, in Latvian Copyright Society, the Court of Justice came back to the issue of economic pricing and introduced alternative test to the cost price test. So there, the court accepted for the first time that also the comparison, for instance, of the price in different member states, if the member states were similar, so for instance, there the excessive pricing was related to the royalties that the Latvian Copyright Society, was the fee, actually, that the Latvian Copyright Society was asking to the copyright holder. And that was much higher in comparison to the fee requested by the Copyright Society in Estonia and Lithuania. And the court concluded that Estonia and Lithuania were similar countries to Latvia, let's say. In terms of, let's say, unfairness, how to prove unfairness, there the court emphasized that the price difference has to be appreciably significant and persistently. So it does not have to take place only once, the excessive pricing, but has to be a sort of repeated event. So what does, let's say, the theory about excessive pricing has to do in that economy? So as I mentioned before, we take the position that in the data economy, personal data are the currency, and they have a sort of economic value, which can decrease even quickly, let's say, but at least it's possible to pay a service with personal data. This is also recognized by the draft directive from 2015 on the sale of digital content, which has not been approved, has not entered into force, but at least the Commission has recognized this possibility. But what does it mean, this idea for excessive pricing? So can we say that if we, let's say, transfer to a platform an excessive amount of personal data, that can be sanctioned under Article 102? Our conclusion in the paper is no. Why not? It would be quite difficult to prove the requirement that we have a significant and persistent excessive pricing in that case. The value of personal data is very subjective. It changes very quickly. And therefore, we consider that it would be very hard, almost impossible, for a competition authority to satisfy the standard of proof required by the Court of Justice in Latvian Copyright Society and United Brands. Similar conclusions are also achieved in relation to discriminatory pricing. So in Article 102.6, the treaty mentioned that applying the similar condition to equivalent transaction with other trading partners, placing them at a competitive disadvantage, is an abuse of dominant position. So the case law, again, comes from United Brands and recently refined in MEO, a ruling of the Court of Justice from April this year. There, for the first time, the Court of Justice clarified that the competitive disadvantage of the party which somehow is discriminated to pay the higher price cannot be taken for granted. The court there applies a sort of assessment of all the relevant circumstances, so the enforcement has to take in consideration all the relevant circumstances to understand the competitive disadvantage. The logic is very similar to the Intel logic from September last year. So somehow here I think the court transferred the Intel ruling to exploitative conduct for the first time. It's the first case in which we have a sort of, I would say, export of Intel to other type of abuse of dominance besides rebates. And among the relevant circumstances, for instance, that enforcement authority or a court should take in consideration is also the strategy of the dominant company. So the strategy to systematically discriminate its customers. Also, the Court of Justice refers to the possibility for the dominant company to put forward objective justification, refers to the idea of the as efficient competitor test among the discriminated customers, and at the end, the court concludes with a sentence saying that overall, it's quite unlikely that the dominant company will discriminate its customers. Why it's unlikely? It's a sort of irrational business strategy. So I read this sentence as a sort of presumption, which can be still rebuttable, that discriminatory pricing does not take place in practice because the dominant company does not have any incentive to impose different prices to its customers. That's the ruling of the Court of Justice in MEO. So, what type of, let's say, lessons can we draw from that for the data economy? So, we know that discriminatory pricing takes place in the data economy. The data analytics favor discriminatory pricing by online platform where we buy, when we purchase a good or service online. Usually, it's mentioned in the literature that data analytics favor the transfer from third-degree price discrimination to first-degree price discrimination to individual pricing. We are still not there. Probably we will be there in 10, 20 years' time when we go online and each of us will see a different price for a certain type of service. But what we see at the moment clearly are forms of called behavioral discriminator. So, for instance, steering, I don't know, if, when you go online and you search on a search engine for certain results, the search engine will steer you, so will guide you to certain type of results dependently by your willingness to buy. So if you are a more affluent customer, you will go to the website or to the offer, which is more expensive than a more budget-oriented customer. Or the repricing, which is a different type of conduct, but basically, at the beginning, when you search online, you see very low price, and then at the end, when you are close to purchase a service, there are add-on which are added on the final price. So, can we sanction discriminatory pricing, behavioral discrimination, under Article 102 on the basis of the case law of the Court of Justice that I mentioned before? I have doubts. Once again, like for SSC pricing, the burden of proof is very high. So to consider all the relevant circumstances when we come to the assessment of the competitive disadvantage will create a very hard burden of proof for the competition authority. So for instance, the competition authority should prove the discrimination in its stable strategy by the platform long term, and it would be very difficult to show it. The consumers themselves don't know to pay different prices. Then there is also a welfare analysis, which is required. Economists argue that discriminatory pricing actually is positive for some consumers and negative for others. So you need to make a welfare balance out of that, which requires a case-by-case analysis. So once again, I think we will not have, at least in the near future, any case of discriminatory pricing sanctioned under 102. This does not mean that we don't have a problem. It means simply that we should look at other areas of law. For instance, I don't know, in the GDPR, there are specific provisions about profiling, no? Which limit the ability, for instance, of an online platform to keep a profile of its customers. Okay? So this is, for instance, a way to limit the ability of a platform to discriminate its customer. So there are, I would say, we need to have a very pragmatic approach and to see what works in one area of law, we can go with that one, or we can push a different approach. Because as I mentioned before, under the AstraZeneca case law, for me, it's clear that we cannot preclude a priori the application of any area of EU law. What about unfair contractual terms? So the case law of the Court of Justice again comes back to United Brands, and then we have a number of judgments which deal with different type of unfair contractual clauses imposed by a dominant undertaking on its customers. We don't have an exhaustive list of what are unfair clauses, okay? But there is generally a broad interpretation. Usually the court indicates unfair clauses which are imposed unilaterally by the dominant company without possibility for the customer to negotiate or to opt out. For instance, in Porto di Genova, shipping companies were obliged to purchase the docking services of the harbor and they could not, let's say, buy the service from any other provider. So we have another case in which the dominant company was obliging the customer to extend automatically the duration of the contract even after the duration of the contract. So, what, let's say, this type of unfair contractual terms have to do with Article 102? As I mentioned before, this is the case which is currently, let's say, investigated by the Bundeskartellamt, the Facebook case. Maria Teresa tomorrow will talk about the Bundeskartellamt investigation. She has a different position than mine. The case is pending, so it's difficult, let's say, to make an assessment before a final decision. I would say let's not condemn a person before committing a crime. So this is a bit my position here. So the Bundeskartellamt is basically investigating whether and to what extent the Facebook practice to transfer personal data of its user to third parties, to the apps, can be considered an unfair contractual clause. Personally, from what I saw from at least the press release that the Bundeskartellamt published in December last year, I would say that this case is rather well grounded. So it fits with the case law of the Court of Justice under Article 102 in terms of exploitative conducts in terms of unfair contractual clause. Then we still need to see the decision. Personally, I hope the case will end up with an infringement decision, not with a settlement, because this is an open issue. It has to go to court, and the court has to refer the case to the Court of Luxembourg. This is the type of case which has to be discussed in Luxembourg, not at the national level, let's say. But I don't go further, and let's see in a couple of weeks what the authority decides. So, remedies. So, a general remarks. So, traditional remedies are, in combination law, are basically fines. Okay, you fine a company because it breaches the law. Okay, and you couple with that a decision imposing to the company to abstain from a certain contract. Think about the Google Shopping case from December last year. No, sorry, it's already 1 year old now. It's June last year. $2 billion fine imposed on Google. Did that solve the issue? Personally, I don't think so. Okay, simply imposing a fine on Google without introducing any type of further remedy does not solve the issue per se and does not prevent Google to do a similar type of behavior in the future. I think in the data economy, where there is a lot of uncertainty, a lot of debate, uncertainty of what is legal and what is not legal, the competition authority should have a more flexible approach and guide the companies. Guiding, for instance, via behavioral commitments. So what is the advantage of behavioral commitments in comparison to other type of remedies like fines? First of all, let's say they can be negotiated with the party, so they are more flexible to the exigencies of the party, to the technicalities of the industry, so they are not unilaterally imposed. They can be tailor-made. And also something which is usually forgotten, let's say, is that they provide for review clauses which are often not taken in consideration. For instance, let's say some review clauses could be conditional. Let's come back to the merger case, Facebook-WhatsApp, that we discussed during the first presentation. So the case was in 2014, the Commission said the two companies will not merge the database, even though all the competitors were arguing that, okay? But they believe to the company. They made a mistake, the Commission was wrong. So the merger took place. Why the Commission at that time, in 2014, did not introduce a behavioral commitment and say, if the parties merge a database, then you will be subject to this type of commitment or sanction, okay? So this would have been a different approach, rather than after 2 years imposing a fine because the parties provided wrong information to the Commission. Wrong information. Everybody knew that Facebook wanted to acquire WhatsApp in order to merge the database of its customers, of its users. Other review clauses could be automatic, in the sense after certain market outcomes takes place, we have a new competitor comes in the market, then remedies are not needed anymore. Or periodic, every 6 months, the parties sit with the competition authority to rediscuss the case. Okay? So this, of course, changes a bit the role of the competition authority. So it's not only sanctioning ex post, it becomes a more regulatory authority. That's evident. But I think this is required in view of the, new development brought by the data economy. So I mentioned before that I don't think a case of excessive and discriminatory pricing in the data economy can, stand the test introduced by the Court of Justice in its case law. But let's suppose that the competition authority makes a case and satisfies the burden of proof. Okay, what are the potential remedies? So this is a type of question that the competition authority will soon have to come up. Even the Bundeskartellamt, if they decide to sanction Facebook, they will decide, okay, what do we do now? Okay, that's why we are trying to think about possible remedies. So here we, again, this is speculation, I would say, because there are no cases. We look at the possible remedies in other industries, as I mentioned at the beginning. So one possibility that we think is about the establishment of an official price comparison website. So we can have a real excessive and discriminatory pricing case if, for instance, if basically the consumers are locked in. So they cannot look, or they are not aware of other offers. Okay. So one possibility, which for instance exists already, in Austria where I live, the Energy Regulatory Authority has established a price comparison website for energy prices. So you are an electricity gas user, you don't know what is the best offer for you, you go on the website of the regulator. And there you include the parameters, they tell you what are the offers of the different providers, and you pick up the best. Austrian electricity and gas market prices are among the most competitive and efficient in Europe. And I think this is one of the reasons. You know that you can switch, you know what is the best offer. You can say very often the market provides price comparison website. Think about airline industry. So when there is already, the market provides the solution, there is no need for a remedy. When on the other hand, there is no that type of solution in the market, the authority could intervene. Other two possibilities are basically limiting the possibility, the categories of data or the retention time of the data that an online platform has about personal data. So let's say once again, online platform can discriminate its customers because of the large amount of data that it owns. Or other possibility, data sharing, imposing a data sharing obligation of the online platform with its competitors, let's say. It's not easy, let's say, to be designed as a type of remedy because, first of all, you don't know what type of data are used or needed by the competitors. Data which are valuable for one firm are not valuable for another firms. You can say that it's a bit excessive, it's a bit regulatory, but once again, I would say this type of remedies should be designed in cooperation with the data protection authority, let's say. It happens for remedies in the field of network industries. I don't see why this cannot happen in, markets characterized by personal data. Then let's briefly talk about unfair contractual clauses. Yes, I will be there. So here we come to the clear overlap with data protection rules. Okay. So we have the GDPR from 25th of May 2015, and that's a very good basis of data protection in Europe. So what is the role then of potential remedies imposed by the competition authority in this field? Our position is that first, the remedy could clarify aspects which are not super clear in the GDPR, because the GDPR is over 100 pages, but there are many, especially when it comes to the rights, which are broad provisions, which now require an interpretation by court and by authorities. And second, we can also think about a situation where the remedies go beyond the GDPR. Think about the discussion about the anonymization. So that is not covered by the GDPR, anonymized data. The remedies imposed by the competition authority, negotiated via commitments by the competition authority, could go beyond the GDPR. Okay? Some examples. Lack of informed consent, which is one of the market failures that we identify in the paper. The authority, the competition authority, can identify what categories of data can be stored, collected by the platform, for how long, for which use. It's a paternalistic approach. Okay? But we can see in exceptional circumstances, when we have a super dominant platform, where we have a clear case of exploitative abuse, then, let's say, the authority can intervene and can replace the consent, which is at the basis of data protection rules. Lack of transparency, we are thinking about a double opt-in. Opt-in is now the default principle in the GDPR. So in order to give your consent to the processing of personal data, you have to opt-in in the types of service, not only opt-out. Okay? But does it really change? Do you think that after the GDPR enter into force, you feel a bit more safeguarded? I receive a lot of emails at the end of May this year, but I don't think the status of my privacy has really changed. I don't feel it, at least. Okay, I'm still, let's say, clicking the box of the all the possible data protection terms, just because we are still in the situation of take it or leave it. So either I accept or I don't get the service. Okay. So for instance, the double opt-in would require an additional opt-in after the first one, where, for instance, you receive an email and you confirm that really you want to accept the data protection terms. Or we are also thinking about a periodic review of the data protection terms every here and then. Okay, I don't have time to talk about data portability. If you have questions, I will come to that. And I now want to jump to the conclusion. So I departed from the idea, from a normative perspective, that competition, data protection, and consumer law serve different objectives. They have different enforcement structures, and they have different goals. So we cannot exclude the a priori, at least, the enforcement of competition law, simply because we can also use data protection and consumer law. Okay. So we are, however, quite keen that we don't want to become regulators. And at least in, let's say, exploitative abuses, exploitative conducts, we should only enforce competition law when we have a super dominance and high and interstable barriers. This is in line with the economic literature, and this is in line with the case law of the Court of Justice. In the data economy, we have a number of conducts which indeed could be considered exploitative conducts, which harm consumers. But the question here is, how we prove, how we satisfy the high burden of proof introduced recently by the Court of Justice. This is the case for excessive and discriminatory pricing. So we think the burden is quite high. We don't think any authority will really apply Article 102 in this field. While we are more open, at least we need still to see the decision of the Bundeskartellamt, but we think that when it comes to unfair contractual terms, then we have a sort of new threats. At least we'll see whether this is confirmed. And then in the paper, as I mentioned before, we also try to look at possible remedies, a question which will be soon be on the table of the competition authority. And we think that at least the authorities, when it comes to unfair contractual terms, could look at the data protection rules, data protection rights, and use them either to interpreting the existing law or to go beyond them. Let's say, in these exceptional circumstances like exploitative conducts. So thank you very much. This is my email. And if you are interested, this is the link to the paper. It's on Social Science Research Network. It's a working paper published a few weeks ago. And we really look forward to receive your feedback in order to improve the paper for publication. Thank you.
So, Professor Lawrence, about that. Thank you very much for your intervention. It was very interesting, and this is normally untouched topic, the exploitative abuses from dominant firms. And if you have questions, suggestions, okay, we have the first one over there.
Thank you for asking the question. I just wanted to push a little bit on the Deutsche Telekom AstraZeneca point. Because you said that those cases set the law that we can apply competition law in already regulated areas to regulated conduct. I suppose I wanted to know whether that, I agree with you that that is the law, but is that the correct approach?
Can I get the papers. Just a second, and I will come back to you. No, okay, I don't find it. But so my position is the following. Let's come back to 10 years ago when we had the liberalization of network industries. The argument and discussion was exactly the same. We have the liberalization directives, we have a regulation. Why should we enforce competition law? And that was clear in Deutsche Telekom that when we have an overlap between different areas of law, we cannot exclude the application of competition law. And this is also confirmed in AstraZeneca. Then afterwards, I can show you the paragraph of the ruling where the court is mentioned this. So as I mentioned before, however, I don't think competition law should pursue different goals than the pure, let's say, economic or consumer welfare protection of solving market failures. Okay, so that's why in our presentation we emphasize, let's say, that we have a number of market failures in the data economy which justify competition law intervention. Again, we cannot talk so much about the Facebook investigation because we don't see the decision. Okay, we will see. The decision will simply say competition law should pursue different goals, also data protection and so on. Then my position is that the decision is wrong. But if it says we have market failures and competition law should intervene to solve them because data protection is not enough, why not? I'm open to that. Okay? This was my answer.
Do you have further questions on the topic? No?
Yes.
Okay. Yes. No, never mind. Go ahead.
So I would just like to ask, how do you define super dominance? Because, what kind of conception of bias do you suppose? A Bayesian one, like whatever makes market entry more difficult, or the one which leads to very different outcome? And related to this, SEP holders, for example, Standard Essential Patents holders, are super dominant companies. And then I have two small questions about the remedy. So when exactly excessive amount of data requested become a problem? Unless there is a pricing at some point, or a quality verification, is there a problem with excessive amount of data? And the other is your remedy. I really enjoyed the discussion, but the other is about the price comparison website, the regulator setting up a price comparison website. But the problem is that there can be a cellophane fallacy. So there can be already a super competitive price in the market, which is not addressed. So we are just comparing bad options.
Mm-hmm. Okay, that's good. I think Nicolo?
Yeah, it's quite close to this. So the argument about excessive pricing, you use the SEP case as an example that it is being, it's a case law that is being revived, but that refers to very specific circumstances, right? Where there is basically a process that allows the companies to become sort of de facto dominant through a declaration, you know, all the circumstances. So how do you export that into the context of data? And when do you define that there is an excessive data, as you was just saying? If you want to refer to the economic value, you know, the first prong of the United Brands case,
yeah.
How do you apply that in the case of excessive data?
Mm-hmm. Okay, so thank you for the interesting question. Okay, first, about super dominance SCP holders. Okay, in the paper, we did not discuss the issue of market power, let's say, in details, because that's outside the scope of our project. But again, we are talking about, if you read the case law of the Court of Justice, both about excessive pricing, discriminatory pricing, unfair contractual clauses, we always talk about very exceptional circumstances, so close to legal monopoly or de facto monopoly, okay? Like, I don't know, Porto di Genova, there was only the harbor authority which could provide the service. United Brands was the only importer of bananas in Europe. Latvian Copyright Society, it's an institution, I think private, which is the only copyright let's say, holder management in the country. I think SEP holder, it's a case of super dominance because you have one SEP, okay? So, I would say it's very difficult, the question, to say how you apply this type of concept in the data economy. I would say it depends. You need to do a case-by-case scenario, let's say. The data economy is based very much on the idea of competition for the market rather than competition in the market. So you have a sort of disruptive innovation, you invent a totally new product, you become a sort of temporary monopolist for that product, up to the point when other competitors will come with a new, totally different product, which will prevail. So the question is, when the competitors and if the competitors will come up with a new product. So it has happened, but I don't think we can take, let's say, a priori, the conclusion that this will always happen. Okay? I don't know if you follow me a bit. Okay? So I don't want to say Amazon or Google are super dominant and they fill with this definition. But I will say we are close to that, okay? Then, about excessive amount of data. My point in the presentation, maybe it was not clear, it's very difficult, if impossible, to define what is an excessive amount of data. That's why I don't think it's possible to enforce Article 102 to sanction excessive pricing in terms of excessive amount of data. I don't think the data value is subjective. Okay, in terms of how much data is considered excessive. It's very subjective. Then about the price comparison website points that you both raised, it's very interesting. I did not think about that, and you are right, actually. And this shows how it's important to present your research, let's say, in public before being published. And I will think about that, let's say, but I think your criticism is correct, and I will probably have to revise the paper on this point. Other points?
If you have more questions, yes. But please introduce yourself before asking the questions.
I'm Johansen. I'm also a PhD student in the Max Planck Institute as well. In relation to the part about remedies, it's very interesting all the solutions that you give in connection to behavioral conduct. But the question is how to maybe coordinate the monitoring of this kind of behavioral commitments when you have different administrative bodies. If you think like commitment like that firm has with competition authority in relation. relation to some data privacy conduct that should be monitored by the data privacy authority. So in the end, it's like we have, I see that we have problems with that are complex, with concerns related to competition, consumer protection, data. We have a lot of authorities, and maybe it would be the case that some of the commitments crash or are in tension with what other authorities are imposing. Yeah, and maybe it's connected with what you say in relation to the political vision that sometimes is in connection with
the case. Yeah. Very good point, Herman. I think this was already raised in the first presentation today. So the point, since 2 years ago, we have this digital clearinghouse at the European level, where we have a sort of discussion between data protection authority, competition law authorities, and okay, this is at the European level, a very general discussion, but I think also at the national level, more cooperation has now been established between the competition authorities and data protection authorities. In Italy, for instance, recently, some months ago, the Italian Telecom Regulatory Authority, AGCOM, the Italian Competition Authority, and the Italian Data Protection Authority started a joint sector inquiry about the data economy. So this shows that cooperation is growing. I think simply you can conclude a memorandum of understanding between these different authorities, with the obligation that when you impose remedy, you need to ask for the opinion of the other authority. And in case of conflict, you sit at the table and you find a common solution. I don't think it's impossible, let's say. It works in the field of network industries. I don't understand why it cannot work in the field of data protection. That's it. I mean, I draw very much a comparison between competition regulation in network industries, debate 10 years ago, it's somehow closed, clear, and the debate that we have today between competition and data protection, which is still open, ongoing, but we can draw some lessons.
Okay, and maybe we just finished here, and